Hey everyone, and welcome to a ranged roundup for Shadowlands. And big surprise, just like with the melee video, we're going to go through all the specs in the game. We're going to break down how they feel to play, the core changes for this expansion that you need to know, and of course, a look at the legendaries and our thoughts as well on them. So, a big fun video for today. Also, good news, the second pin that you will get in this month's Patreon has arrived, and it is the Demon Hunter class pin. It's got a real sexy gold luster, and of course, we also have got the 2020 edition of the channel pin, as well as the art and the sticker. So, a lot of stuff. If you sign up in November and then you wait until, of course, Patreon does the charging thing on the 1st of December, then once that happens, we'll send them along to you. Bunch of cool loot, and also, it massively helps out what we're able to do. I mean, you guys are incredible. You've created two jobs, which is allowing us to do so much more for our Shadowlands coverage. It's all very awesome. So, thank you. Check the stuff out. And with that said, let's get into the ranged classes. BM Hunter is highly similar to BFA. Yes, you are still trying to maintain your barbed shot uptime for frenzy and your pet, while, of course, lamenting your wild call RNG. You're still going to be getting two kill commands into your Bestial Wrath windows. That is all as it was. Bestial Wrath has had a change, though, but it's not one that I would have liked. Rather than be off the GCD, which would feel so much better than it does right now, given the pretty tight barbed shot timings and how that stuff can line up, no, it still is on the GCD, but Blizzard have made it so that whenever you use it, your pet does a mild amount of damage, so they're trying to make it being on the GCD feel okay because it's an attack, but basically, nah, it doesn't actually feel that good to use. I really think it should be off the GCD, just like how Rhett Paladin got Avenging Wrath off the GCD. That is such a big room for improvement, it'd be so easy to do. Now, a few talents have also been modified for this one, with the new one being Bloodshed. Bloodshed's not great in my opinion. So it's a 1 minute cooldown that basically makes your pet do a bleed in the target, and that increases the amount of damage taken from your pet by 15%. So you're thinking, okay, I want to line that up with my Bestial Wraths. Sure, you want to do that, but the cooldowns often just don't line up, and that doesn't feel great. Plus, it is on the GCD, so when they do line up, you've got to use it in the GCD, and then Bestial Wrath on the GCD as well. So yes, doing that back-to-back sucks. Add in, say, the Kyrian Covenant ability, and hey, there you go. You've got another cooldown that's on the GCD. This is the one thing that I think really feels bad in this spec, genuinely bad. Now, the core of the spec does feel pretty damn good. You have got excellent movement, you've got a nice, smooth damage profile, you've got a whole bunch of utility, I mean, between Feign Death, Trank, Disengage, Turtle, you know, you've got so much. Now, look, it is really annoying that one thing the GCDs, so this may not all sound completely rosy, but what I will say is that, yeah, this spec is just one that actually fits really well when you're playing WoW content, and for me, you know, I can roll this, I can get a nice weak aura, so I can get the most out of barbed shot, and then I can just really get down to what I truly love, and that is engaging with Blizzard's boss design in raids. So that's the core there. Let's talk about legendaries. Dire Command is just not that interactive. It's a bit boring. I mean, hey, you get another pet, but boring. There's Flamewalker's Cobra Sting. That gets you a nice bit of proc gameplay, which surely will increase the pace of things a little bit more, which I think could be quite fun. There's then Quapla, which is a bit wild. It makes it so that Barbed Shot reduces the cooldown of both Kill Command and Bestial Wrath. And, you know, something that does risk being inefficient, but it can result in a nice bit of gameplay where you can do a kill command and then a barbed shot, which will reduce your kill command CD by like 5 seconds. And so then you can just, you know, go do another kill command. So that gives you that nice little sort of rhythm. Yeah, I mean, that might be a bit idealistic of me, though, because obviously you overall do want to maintain barbs at all costs because of frenzy stacks, so you might not always be able to do that. Then the final one is really boring in terms of spec specifics. It just increases pet crit damage during Bestial Wrath. Overall here, I'm going to say it's not a thrilling selection. Now, the general legendaries have their ups, like the one that lets you send a flare into a tar trap to make an explosion. That's just cool. But the others just don't really feel great. I mean, one of them is a 35% cooldown reduction for your main cooldown. And then, I mean, the others are just, you know, there's like a Feign Death one. It's just not really that great. So overall here's what I'll say. This spec has its flaws, and it has its missed opportunities. but it fundamentally does fit pretty damn well into playing World of Warcraft because of the great utility, the damage profile that I like, and just generally speaking, like, you can do everything on the move. That is so, I mean, it does feel pretty fun. It actually can feel kind of busted in raids. So yeah, that's it for BM. Marksmanship Hunter is now surprisingly better than I thought, and that's owing to a last minute change, but overall it still is mixed. So the core gameplay is the same as it was in BFA, right? Your heavy and slow aim shots that give you stacks of precise shots that buff up your arcane shot, and then of course your focus regen via rapid fire, which is now a bit shorter, and steady shot. Now, those things have had their values tweaked up a little bit, such that they generally do work better than they did in BFA, which is nice. But what I think really matters is that Blizzard have revamped True Shot, your main cooldown. So now it is a 60% cooldown decrease to rapid fire and aim shot, and a 50% increase to your focus regen. So basically, it is this big period of you just going aim shot, rapid fire, aim shot. You know, rapid fire, right? It's just really, really quick. And it feels so much better to play than it did with the old version of True Shot. It's actually enough to give the spec a bit of a sense of pace. So if you combine that with their already pretty fun trick shot mechanic for AoE, and they're looking surprisingly, I'd say good, but then I think about talents, which is where I then have to downgrade them to okay, because the talents are fine. Actually, they're not really that great. To cut a very long story short here, there are not nearly as many interactive talents that actually play with the core of the spec than I would like. So many of them are vestigial, right? They are abilities like Serpent Sting and, you know, the Raven one that are kind of just there because they were hunter abilities in the past, and not really because they are the best talents for the design of marksmanship as it is designed now. In short, yes, they feel vestigial, right? There's just these talents that just take up space and don't really add to the fun gameplay of the spec's core mechanics. Now, you totally can get a fun talent combo. I mean, Deadeye is an example of a really, really good talent, right? That actually makes use of us now having Killshot. And I think that's the point. It's one of the few new hunter talents that we've got. That's kind of why it's really cool. But generally speaking, the talents are a big letdown. They need looked at. They're kind of just boring. I could do a full rundown, but this ain't the video for that. So overall, the core of this spec is actually more solid than I thought, but precise shots is a bit boring, and I think the talents basically just, it's just not a great talent tree. It's not that fun. If they can fix those things, remove some of those vestigial elements of the spec's past, then it could be in a far better state. What then about the legendaries? Well, this is where things are actually interesting enough. So, Eagle Talon's True Focus makes True Shot feel even better by making it so that your focus costs are reduced during True Shot, and that means you just do a lot more during True Shot, right? You can actually weave in some of those precise shots as well. So that's pretty neat. There's Unblinking Vigil, which is real fun when in AoE, and there is also Surging Shots that gives you a bit of a faster sense of pace. There is one that applies Serpent Sting whenever you aim shot. Now, in a lot of scenarios, that is just super boring. There is gameplay in sort of cleaving that, or not cleaving, but, you know, using that to help to spread your serpent stings. I don't find it to be super exciting, though, for what I want from MM. So that's what's up for their spec-specific ones. I've already covered the general Hunter Legendaries when doing Beast Mastery, but I will say that Call of the Wild's 35% reduction to True Shot's cooldown does feel even better when True Shot is now a way more fun cooldown for us to use. So overall then, this was, I think, not great in BFA. I think it still has some fundamental issues now, but I think the tweaks and the new sort of main design of True Shot just makes this leagues more fun to me. There's a lot of room for improvement in patches and future expansions, but we're getting closer to a really good base core here. Shadow Priest has been revamped, now having a design that I think will fit the game a bit better than the old one and be a bit more balance friendly for Blizz in the long run. Is it fun? Yes. Yes, it is. You generate insanity with Mind Blast, use Mind Flay as your filler, you do your dots with Shadow Word Death being also there for your execute range. What's different though is that you're spending your insanity on Devouring Plague, which does some instant damage, a strong dot, and it actually heals you up a bit as well. That's the core, right, of this new version of the Shadow Priest. You maintain your dots, you generate your insanity, you use that in your Devouring Plague as your spender. Now, though, there are some other things. So, Shadow Dots can give you an instant cast of Mind Blast, and that's one that you can actually cast while you're channeling Mind Flay, so that's a bit wacky. It's a very different core gameplay style to the old Shadow Priest. Very much is. And I've got to say, it really does work for me. Now, also, Void Form is different, so Void Eruption will send you into Void Form, as it did, and it's castable every 90 seconds. So it's a different design, it's a cooldown now. You still get Void Bolt, which will, you know, add to the duration of your dots, it'll give you your increased spell damage, you know, you also get your chance of, or your charge of Mind Blast whenever you use it. And sure, it's not as crazy as the super extended Void Forms of the past, but it very much is, I would say, still a fun, gameplay-impacting cooldown to use that is a part of an otherwise very fun-to-play spec. Now, it actually gets great when you go into the talents, too. I mean, Unfurling Darkness gives you both single target utility and some nice sort of AoE dotting, which is pretty cool. It pairs great with Misery, which makes Vampiric Touch apply Shadow Word Pain. There's other great ones. I mean, Searing Nightmare is just interesting enough in that it's an insanity spender that you cast while you are casting Mind Sear, which is your AoE filler, and it will spread Shadow Word Pain in an AoE when you're doing that, or what it can do is do more damage if there's already Shadow Word Pain on those targets, but that's pretty neat. What's also cool is it meshes perfectly with Psychic Link, which makes Mind Blast also damage targets inflicted by Shadow Word Pain. So that's a pretty nice flow for your AoE. Then you've got stuff like Shadow Crash, which it's not super innovative, but you know, it's sort of simple, but it just looks pretty cool, sending a big Void Boy, you know, in at AoE. And the rest of the talent picks are generally great too. Basically, right, this is a really, really well-designed core spec. It's got really great talents. Blizzard have essentially nailed this one. So, what about legendaries then? Well, one of them gives Mind Flay and Mind Seer a chance to spawn a Void minion that does damage and generates insanity, so a bit more on the simple side, but it is a pace increase, which could be nice. Another is really cool. It makes Shadow Word Death take duration from the Shadow Word Pain and Vampiric Touch on your target. Does that, it instantly deals their damage and it generates insanity. So that is, like, that's just a whole new rotational button. Really changes things up. That's a really cool Lego. I just love Legos like that. They really do change things. Another essentially just buffs your Shadow Fiend, and another one then gives you a 60% damage boost to Mind Blast whenever Shadow Word Pain, Vampiric Touch, and Devouring Plague are on the target. So if you can line those things up, you will be rewarded for doing so. As for the general ones then, well, really there's not that much for damage. It's more survivability and healing in those ones, which does make sense because, I mean, you are mostly on a healing class. So overall, this is a great spec. It fits just about all the instanced content really well. It's a joy to play for me. It is just an excellent, well-designed spec. Elemental Shaman has had its ups and downs over beta, and it comes out fairly strong, mostly by virtue of minor changes. The removal of Maelstrom as a mechanic was, of course, rolled back by Blizzard, so it's basically the same as it was in BFA. Now, Flame Shock requires a bit more maintenance because it is down to a 18-second duration from 24 seconds. Then Elemental Blast will now generate you some Maelstrom, and there are two new talents. You've got Static Discharge and Echoing Shock. Given the rather drastic removal of Maelstrom in the alpha, this is a bit more than surprising how it's turned out, right? Given that it seems like they wanted to do a bit of a rework, but really that was off the table, and they, of course, removed Maelstrom and then put it back in again when it turned out the removal wasn't really working that well. So, as it stands then, Elemental is as it was. It's a perfectly fine spec with a few limited mechanics and the option to add more mechanics into its gameplay via the talents, although the interactions between them are limited. You've got, so to go into the new things then, you've got the new Echoing Shock, which, I mean, it used to duplicate, it was cool, right? It would actually duplicate the buffs from your Elemental Blast, or say your Ice Fury, but now it just replicates the damage, so it's a bit less interactive, a bit less interesting. But everything else is mostly identical. I mean, Echo of the Elements, it still isn't baseline. That is insane to me. Echo of the Elements should be baseline. But basically, right, this means that Elemental Shaman is about Flame Shock, Lava Burst procs, and Maelstrom. Same as always. And you know what? These things actually flow together pretty well. And hey, pumping chain lightnings into a group of mobs, that feels just as good as ever. But if you're expecting something a bit more monumental, a bit more different for a change, you're out of luck. And that said, at least having Spirit Walker's Grace come over from the resto spec, you know, be baselined, gives you a nice sort of tool to handle movement, so that's pretty sweet. Now, as for the legendaries, more of the same, playing with the elements. You've got Skybreaker's Fiery Demise that gives Flame Shock a 30% increased crit and reduces the cooldown of Fire Elemental when it does crit. Not a massive amount of gameplay, but that could be quite nice once you spread them around. There's Elemental Equilibrium, which is one of the most interesting ones. It cycles spell school damage. Direct fire damage buffs the next frost spell, which buffs the next nature spell, which buffs the next fire spell. Now, if you're running that along with Master of the Elements, oh, some awkward gameplay, but it is awkward gameplay that is somehow kind of satisfying. Then we've got Echoes of Great Sundering, which gives each earthquake after an earthshock an extra 250% damage, and then there is Windspeaker's Lava Resurgence that forces earthshock to proc Lava Burst and increase its damage. So some neat gameplay in that one, actually. All in all then, pretty fun talents, and actually some pretty fun legendaries. You can get a few awkward and crowded combinations if you, because you have all these toys you can opt into using. So if you opt into all of them at the same time, it's going to be a big old mess, but it is some pretty nice gameplay customization. So there you go. Elemental, it is its own brand of builder, spender, caster, and it's pretty damn solid. Balanced Druid is definitely one of the more controversial shakeups that Shadowlands has seen. Inspired by older designs, Blizzard are switching back to, the solar and lunar eclipses that will buff the corresponding core abilities for you. This time, though, you trigger the eclipse by casting two of the opposite spell. And while that is a fun idea, it does result in some fairly unintuitive gameplay. I mean, having to spend over 4 seconds hard casting Starfires because you want a solar eclipse so that you can use Wrath, that takes a lot of getting used to. You've just got to have a few seconds of suck to trigger the thing that you actually want to do. And that doesn't sound like that much, but if you are there basically casting two AoE spells to start your single target, and vice versa, it can feel awkward. And that's especially now when Star Surge now buffs your current eclipse. That means you want to only spend your astral power at the start of an eclipse window, and ideally the right eclipse window for the gameplay you actually want to do. Now, along with these eclipse changes, Celestial Alignment is now off the GCD and grants both of the eclipses simultaneously. Hey, off the GCD, that's pretty good. Starfall then is actually a good thing. It is back to being a buff centered on the Druid. So, you know, you just click it and bam, the stars fall around you, rather than it being a ground targeted ability. I think it's a lot more fun. Plus, you can talent into Stellar Drift, and whenever that's up, bam, you cast while moving. Pretty sweet. Now, beyond some balance changes then, most of their talents do remain similar enough. The biggest change is that Shooting Stars is now baseline, and its slot is taken up by a talent that buffs it instead. All in all then, the core change is controversial here. It is the eclipses. There is plenty of depth to playing those eclipses correctly. You know, using your bad eclipse for, because you do basically TikTok between the two of them. So, you know, maybe you want to do it so that whenever you're in the eclipse, it's not really ideal for what you want to do. Maybe that's when you really try to refresh all your dots and use your talented abilities. But I'd still say that fundamentally, swapping between eclipses while doing content in the world and, you know, chaining short fights together feels terrible. I don't like it. I think it sucks. Sorry, Blizzard, I don't think this was a successful change. Sure, some druids will disagree with me, but I don't like the new eclipses. Now, Balance's legendaries are pretty cool. Or, I mean, look, at least if we had some more control over the eclipses, but just the way that it's kind of like, hey, you're on this ride, you're stuck on it, that's it. Doesn't do it for me. The legendaries are pretty cool, though. I will say that. Most of them are actually returning favorites. Oneth's is back, giving each Star Surge and Star Fall a chance to make the other one free. So that's pretty cool. And if you're in a build that's also using Stellar Drift, then you'll get a lot of casting while moving when you're doing that, and that'll be quite cool. There's Arcanic Pulsar that's also back, although it triggers now triggers Celestial Alignment every 300 AP spent rather than every 9 Star Surges, so you got that. There is Time-Worn Dreambinder that gives Star Surge and Starfall a cost reduction and a power boost when used for 6 seconds, stacking twice. Then there's Balance of All Things that gives 50% crit chance with Arcane slash Nature spells when you're entering an eclipse, and that drops off quickly, that buff. There's a generic, actually, Druid legendary that bodes kind of poorly for balance, though. Cycle of Life and Death increases the speed of dots by 25% and hots by 15%. Now, this is obviously very strong in AoE and with Stellar Flare selected, but I will say that needing to refresh your dots 25% more often, I think that will actually take away from balance's actual core gameplay, so not the best legendary for fun. So overall for me, there are some nice changes, right, with Starfall and stuff, but fundamentally, I don't like the new Eclipse. And if you don't like the new Eclipse, you're just not going to like playing this spec. I think that's basically the situation we're in. Affliction, then, is one of the clear winners from Blizz's tinkering. Moving from Legion to BFA took away just a little too much, and it resulted in it feeling a bit lifeless, and that was kind of sad. But in Shadowlands, good things are afoot. It now has Malefic Rapture as its Soul Shard spender, dealing damage to every single enemy based on the number of dots on those enemies. While then, Unstable Affliction is free, doesn't cost soul shards anymore, and it's now got a limit of a single application, so that's the thing you put on your primary target. Shadow Embrace, the stacking damage debuff, is now baseline, which will help them out in either single target or when funneling. They also then have their usual strong multi-dot capability. I mean, obviously, it's an Affliction Warlock, and that then feels, their multi-dotting feels so much nicer when you spread all your dots and then you Malefic Rapture, and you just see all of those damage numbers appear in your screen from all the targets you've dotted up. Really satisfying. Just set them up, knock them down gameplay. I love it. Their usually boring single target then is so much better with these tools. You know, refreshing all your dots optimally, spending shards at the right time, and keeping Shadow Embrace stacked fully with your filler. Yeah, that makes for gameplay that's just stressful enough to be fun. Really cool. One of their legendaries then adds another bit of management on single target too. Malefic Wrath is basically reverse Shadow Embrace, so instead of Shadow Bolt granting extra damage, using Malefic Rapture stacks extra damage for Shadow Bolt. So that's a bit of a change. Playing Aflok optimally will not be easy, but it's fun to try. Their other legendaries then are, there's things like, say, the Returning Corruption Slow, some extra shards from Agony, and a short stacking periodic damage buff whenever targets die with Agony. Overall then, Aflok shows a lot of promise. If you're into spinning a few plates and you love multi-dotting, I think this is such a great pick. They have, I think, done a great job with their tweaking here. A massive thumbs up goes to the Aflok. Demonology Warlock has had some of its most popular problems fixed, but not a whole lot else. That's a bit tricky. That said, after 2 expansions without a reliable interrupt, their Felguard's Axe Toss will now interrupt the target if they are stun immune. So you got your interrupt. Phew. Beyond that, then, they have had only a wave of minor changes. I mean, Demonic Tyrant now grants 5 shards whenever it's cast. The Demonic Calling Talent now makes the Dreadstalker's proc free. And Demonic Consumption now empowers the Tyrant based on all of your demons, not just your imps. So that's good. But fundamentally, nothing's really that different, but they are a bit nicer to play. Where does that leave us? Well, they still have that fantasy of summoning a variety of demons with hard casts built from instant demon bolts and, you know, capitalizing on all their flock of demons by summoning in a tyrant. That's awesome! But none of their core gameplay problems were solved either. and that's maybe less awesome, and that's really our issue. It's where the rubber hits the road. Because in gameplay, I'll say this, it has a nice flow between its core abilities, and it's a pretty good overall experience, but it has issues, right? It's got the limited mobility. It's got a long setup time without great payoff for your setup. And ultimately, it needs to solve some of the mobility, needs to solve some of its damage profile, and just those problems where, yes, the core of it's fun, but it struggles to actually fit into World of Warcraft in realistic scenarios. I think it's telling that the time where it did see some, you know, insanely, well, some real life, is whenever there was insanely high haste at the end of patch 8.3. But without that insanely high haste and without borrowed power to prop them up, they do feel pretty weak. Now, their new borrowed power legendaries, this is sad to me, they don't do much. So, implosive potential makes a return from Azerite, so implosion will get you, plenty of haste and AoE, but fixing a fundamental flaw via a Azerite trait, or a legendary for the future, is a bit grim. There's some additional gameplay in Bale Spider's Burning Core that basically grants a stacking damage buff to Demon Bolt from Shadow Bolt casts. That's basically another buff to actually keep rolling in single target, so there is that. There's then Grim Inquisitor's Dread Calling, which just buffs Dreadstalkers for each Hand of Gul'dan cast. And then there is Forces of the Horned Nightmare. And what that does is it gives Hand of Gul'dan a chance at a free follow-up cast, which in fairness could be a fun little pace increase to use. Now, the Warlock General Legendary, Relic of Demonic Synergy, that could be useful too, because it gives a fairly regular 15% damage increase for you or your primary demon when the other one deals damage, so it could be useful. So overall here, our situation is that there are a few nice changes, but it still is going to struggle because of its fundamental weaknesses and how it fits the game. So that's their situation. Destruction has seen usability improvements and talent fixes. Soulfire now applies Immolate and generates a Soul Shard on a 45-second cooldown, so it may actually see some playtime now. Then Shadowburn, that is now a talented 2-charge spender with an Execute component, so there's a bit more there for you. Then now Roaring Blaze has been redesigned to add some gameplay, where now Conflag will basically increase damage done by some of the more fire-based abilities for a short time. That's kind of neat. Now, on the AoE side, Inferno and Fire and Brimstone have actually been buffed significantly to potentially compete with Cataclysm, which would be quite nice. Then Grimoire of Supremacy, that has been changed to Reign of Chaos, which is pretty good RTS, but also gives Soul Shard spenders a chance to summon extra Infernals whenever your Summon Infernal is active. Now, when the baseline changes, the only thing is that Havoc goes from 10 seconds to 12 seconds in duration, which I think is pretty cool, because Havoc's awesome. Destro basically is already pretty fun to play, so these additions and tweaks basically are all nice. Sadly, they still do suffer from having a much longer pet cast time by default, though having the Fel Domination ability that gives you a half second summon does help out where necessary, but it still just feels a bit punitive, to be honest, as a change from Blizz. Hunter's got that too. Destruction then, I'd say, is looking pretty well in Shadowlands overall. You know, it's like with the Fire Mage, it misses some Azerite, it misses some essences, but it still is a good spec in its core gameplay design. You know, the game design is solid, basically. As for its Legos, then, they serve as minor improvements. One will make the target afflicted by Havoc take 25% more damage from single target spells, and that actually will give Havoc a purpose in single target scenarios, so that's kind of cool. There's Cinders of Azhakir that gives Conflag an additional charge and reduces its cooldown, which, when you do it, speeds up the spec pretty drastically thanks to Backdraft. Now, combined with Shadowburn as a talented instant spender, you can actually get a version of Destro that's a bit more mobile than before, which many people will like. Madness of the Azhakir then actually just gives Chaos Bolt basically a buff mechanic, so for 3 seconds, further Chaos Bolts are 20% faster and do more damage. So basically, if you want to chain cast your Chaos Bolts, that one is going to be for you. There then is Embers of the Demonic Raiment that just doubles the shards generated by Incinerate, which might work pretty well for the new Fire and Brimstone for sustained AoE, but otherwise is kind of boring by comparison. Overall then, this is a strong spec. It still has the usual trade-offs, but you accept those, and then what do you have? You have a really solid spec. Arcane continues to make spamming one button kind of fun. That's a bit surprising, isn't it? So look, it's not massively different in Shadowlands, but it definitely is better. And that is a mean feat. It's good stuff from Bliss. Having Rune of Power changed to spawn whenever Arcane Power is pressed is a fantastic change, especially when, wait for it, Arcane Power is now off the GCD. Oh, it's so much better. In fact, most of Arcane's setup time has been removed or shortened. That's awesome. At Touch of the Magi, then, its old damage window artifact ability is baseline and fills Arcane charges. And while it was one of the quieter specs during the beta, and this is kind of cool, it actually had almost all of its complaints from the alpha solved. So for the two main complaints, the setup time being removed, well, that's great. It makes it feel so much smoother to play. And then the new Arcane Echo talent at least gives him the option of having nice windows of ranged burst AoE. And that's a fun experience too, done through pumping Arcane missiles into your now exploding Touch of the Magi target. Pretty nice. The core of the spec remains what it is and has been, right? You know, managing your mana against your cooldowns, ensuring you've got enough mana to burn when you really need to by just spamming more arcane blasts, and then conserving it otherwise by, you know, keeping your charges cycling. Like with Frost's simplicity, just pressing arcane blast, missiles, and occasionally barrage, it's surprisingly fun, and it's surprisingly fun because of the interactivity of the spells and the core design of the spec. It's just cool. Legos then help it out pretty nicely as well, with Arcane Bombardment giving them an execute phase via Arcane Barrage. That's pretty neat. There's Arcane Infinity giving them a huge barrage via damage stacks. There is Siphon Storm attaching Arcane Charges and a ton of intellect to Evocation. They also have a returning favorite, although it sadly is a bit nerfed, and that is Temporal Warp. That will let you use Time Warp a second time, a second Bloodlust. It's okay, it's 15% haste for 20 seconds, so it's not really a second Bloodlust, but nonetheless, it's pretty cool. Arcane can take a while to get used to, yes, but now more than ever, it's a really satisfying spec to play. I'll definitely say that. Having that mana bar to blast through just when you need it, it's a really cool, unique form of gameplay, right? This is one of those ones, it's not just another caster. It really does feel unique, and I think it's really fun. So, once again, GG Blizz. Fire, then, has had a extremely good rap coming out of BFA, and that's, you know, after, say, Essences, Corruptions, and a certain set of bracers, giving them truly incredible power. And that means they feel weaker now. Obviously, a lot of people have been commenting on this. They feel weaker, but the base gameplay is still really good, right? It still is fire. All those strengths are there. It's just the sort of wacky power of late BFA is not there. The only change to worry about then is having Phoenix Flames be baseline and now be a tool for spreading your ignite. So that is a design change to the gameplay. As a complete picture then, their core is, it's very similar, but maybe a little bit slightly worse than it was. Basically, it's all about fishing for crits, converting a crit to an instant pyro with Fire Blast during your fireball cast, and then firing off an instant pyro at the same time as, the finished fireball, right? You know, just all your procs kind of happen at once, and you just kind of go pew, 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 and a whole bunch of stuff comes out. And it's pretty satisfying. Their combustion window, then, is... it is what it is. A bunch of explosive instant casts. You are hurling out all this fire, and it's fun. Right, it's great. Their AoE is then basically just that, but then the new thing is you have to spread your ignites at your peak points of damage by using Phoenix Flame. So you want to track your ignites and they get real chunky, Phoenix Flames goes in. Season Fire Mages will have a lot to say against ignite spreading with Phoenix Flames because of its importance as part of the combustion rotation. So do keep that in mind, but there you go, it's a design change. Basically then, despite Blizzard's efforts, as we move on, their talents remain pretty weak in terms of options, especially compared to Frost. They have only one new passive talent to replace Phoenix Flames, and the others have been rebalanced. You know, good first steps, but there's still a ways to go here, I would say. The last notable change then is Arcane Explosion. Having a off-spec ability is mostly useless as a mage, but fire totally lacks from quick burst AoE damage, and Arcane Explosion provides a bit of that, so that's a bit weird. Now then, as for its Legos, well, it has some big RNG with Firestorm, which can give each hot streak a chance to grant 5 seconds of instant crit pyros and flame strikes, so that's pretty mental. On the more reasonable end, Molten Skyfall drops a meteor every 25 fireballs, Sun King's Blessing grants a buff every 12 hot streaks, a hardcast pyro consumes this buff then to give 5 seconds of combustion, so that's pretty cool, and that might actually help out to sort of smooth out their combustion-reliant damage spikes. Then the other Lego, Fevered Incantation, gives each consecutive crit stacking crit damage. This goes the other way then, buffing the combustion window or lucky crit streaks pretty nicely. Overall then, the Fire Mage still is, I think, a really fun core design. It's just frenetic. You respond to things. It's visually and audibly satisfying. Phoenix Flames Spreading Ignite, to me, is a cool design, but I think to many it will be a poor solution to the real problem of their AoE. Utilizing a Flame Strike or Dragon's Breath maybe would have been a better move there to do that. I think you could totally make that argument. Overall then, look, fire is fire. There's a few little sort of lingering niggles, quibbles, whatever, but at its core, it's fire. I think it's really fun. Early numbers do indicate that maybe other specs will outshine it in terms of, playability and stuff, but I still do think that the Fire Mage is a well-designed and fun spec in the game. Next, Frost, which seems to be, as far as Blizzard are concerned, in a really good spot. And I think they could be right. Outside of the changes that are there across all of the mages, really, when you look at Frost, there's barely really anything in terms of major change. It's pretty damn simple. Now, the most fundamental change is that Flurry applies 2 stacks of Winter's Chill with each damage tick. This makes double Ice Lance the way to play without needing, specific haste, distance, and latency. So that is good. Now, fundamentally, this doesn't change their gameplay. They're still very much what they are, right? They're about spamming your Frost Bolts and then reacting to your Flurries or your Ice Lance procs. However, this is a bit weird. There was a recent update on the beta that makes it apply 2 stacks only once. Instead of casting Frostbolt to do the Shatter combo with Flurry, now, Frost Mages are cancelling Frostbolt if they get a Brain Freeze proc in order to get 2 Ice Lances in. Now, basically that means you gain damage by cancelling the cast of the Frostbolt that you should be doing. This is presumed to be a bug by the player base because it's very counterintuitive and it puts an emphasis on reacting fast enough to cancel a spell cast. But Blizzard haven't commented, so we don't know what's going on there, probably a bug. Otherwise though, they're the same as always and they're in a pretty damn good spot for it. It is less exciting than fire with its explosive high points and, it's less involved than, say, Arcane's mana management, but hey. It's simple, it's satisfying, it's got a variety in its pacing, and it's got a few different talent builds, with Ebb and Bolt and Glacial Spike being there as different ways to spice up your rotation. So it's Frost, it's really solid. The legendaries are also pretty solid, changing the gameplay up just a little. Now, the best looking one to me is Freezing Winds. This gives you a Fingers of Frost charge every 2.5 seconds whenever Orb is up, and that kind of gives you a period of, I suppose, just mostly instant casts. It's pretty sweet. Another one is Slick Ice. That gives Frostbolt a 5% cast time reduction per cast during Icy Veins, and this stacks up to 50%, so you are just this Frostbolt Gatling gun that is pretty fun to watch, so there's that. Now, This is not to say that they're perfect, though. The Altered Time Discord has actually got a Frost Mage simulator on GitHub that uses their own redesign. It's really cool. And on that, they have Flurry based on a charge system instead of procs. And it feels way better to play with. Maybe Blizzard should consider it. And their experiments are really cool, by the way, if you want to check them out. So, look, Frost is Frost. It's really solid, dependable. It's got strong damage profiles. It can do just about anything you throw at it, right? It's a fantastic default mage and a fantastic starter mage as well. So, yeah, that's what's up with Frost. It's in a good state. Overall, then, we're in a situation where the specs, generally speaking, are doing very well for range, and it's about the type of gameplay that you enjoy. All three mages are great. Affliction is great, Destro is great, Demo a bit less so. Shadow is great, Elemental is solid. The two hunters are good, but they could both be significantly improved if Blizzard actually just committed more to their talents. For me, though, really the only losers, and the losers are clear for me, but there's only really two. I don't like the new balanced Druid's Eclipse mechanic, and it has been a controversial enough one. And Demo, as much as it's cool and fun, it struggles in real-world scenarios in the game. Bar those, I would say, any of these choices are good at a fundamental level because the designs are fundamentally good. Now, this, of course, will, vary from patch to patch as the balance of the game ebbs and flows. And that's where being a Warlock, Hunter, and Mage is pretty good, because it doesn't, you know, whether it's Fire, Frost, or Arcane that's in vogue, well, fine, they're all really fun. With the two Hunter ones, I have my gripes, but I'm pretty happy to play either of them. And yes, even with all of that and me really liking the Warlocks and the Mages, yeah, I'm still thinking the Hunter for my main, because I really want that mobility and that sort of ability to be the person who's doing more stuff in raids. But any of those, you know, you're kind of protected against the sort of shifting of the spec balance, because you at least have got two options of, you know, DPS spec with each one of those classes. Now, that said, if you were to tell me I have to choose a spec that also will let me heal, for me, it's obvious, and this is something I plan to do, it's the Shadow Priest, because I would take that over the balanced Druid any day, and generally I would just take it over the Elemental Shaman. So that's basically a roundup of ranged. As you can see, I think thus far, yeah, stuff's generally pretty good. There's obviously a few issues we've highlighted in this video, but we are moving in a better direction. All I'll say is this: Blizzard, take the GCD off things for BM hunters. Jangle up the talents a bit, and you'll have a truly incredible spec. Come on, just do it. Anyway, with my parting message completed, that is it for me. Let me know what you think about the various different specs. What ones are you planning to play, and is the spec that you're planning to play different to what it was in the past expansion? Do let me know. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.